In this video, we are going to study about the dural folds. So before going in detail about the dural folds, we'll see some general features of the cranial cavity. So this is the vault of the cranial cavity. When you see the vault, it is more or less uniform. When you see the base is divided into three fossae, that is the anterior cranial fossa, the middle cranial fossa, and the posterior cranial fossa. They appear in a descending pattern. The cranial cavity consists of brain. You have the brain, then you have blood and the cerebrospinal fluid. The brain is covered from outside inwards by three meninges. So you have the outer dura mater, middle arachnoid mater, and inner pia mater. So the coverings of brain or the dura mater, so this is the dura mater, then you have, this is the arachnoid mater, and this is the pia mater. When you see the dura mater is tough and the arachnoid spreads like spider webs, and the pia mater intimately covers all the irregularities of the surface of the brain. The cranial dura possesses three characteristic features. It consists of an outer endosteal layer, so this is the endosteal layer, and inner meningeal layer, so this is the meningeal layer. So the cranial dura has two layers, an outer endosteal layer and inner meningeal layer. The outer endosteal layer forms the endocranium of the skull bones. So they form the endocranium or the periosteum of the skull bones. And it is traversed by meningeal vessels to supply most of the adjacent bone. Therefore, the cranial dura possesses no extra dural space. Next, the meningeal layer. The meningeal layer of the dura is fused with the endosteal layer all over except where it projects inward in the form of folds. So here it will separate from the periosteal layer. So these folds are called as dural folds. The dural folds we'll see in detail later. The function of the dural folds is to minimize the rotatory displacement of the brain. The tentorium cerebelli divides the cranial cavity into intercommunicating supratentorial and infratentorial compartments. Most of the dural venous sinuses are lodged along the line of separation between the endosteal and the meningeal layer. So here you can see this is the dural venous sinuses where the periosteal layer or the endosteal layer and the meningeal layer separates. So here you have the dural venous sinuses. These sinuses receive blood from the brain and its meninges and from the bone of the calvaria via diploic vein and communicates with the extracranial veins through the emissary veins. Some of the dural sinuses acts as a site of absorption of cerebrospinal fluid through the arachnoid granulation tissue. Next we'll see about the arachnoid mater. The arachnoid mater is separated from the dura mater by a subdural space, which is filled with a capillary layer of tissue fluid, and it is traversed by the cerebral veins on their way of termination into the dural venous sinuses. The hydraulic traction exerted by the film of fluid prevents the separation of the arachnoid from the dura. The arachnoid mater is separated from the pia mater by a space that is known as subarachnoid space. The subarachnoid space contains the cerebrospinal fluid and most of the arteries of the brain. In some area of the brain, the subarachnoid space is enlarged to form the cisternae, which collects the CSF from the fourth ventricle through the foramen of Magenti and the foramen of Lushka. The third layer is the pia mater. The pia mater consists of epipia, which lines the arachnoid mater, and pia glia or pia intima, which covers the brain surface. Both epipaya and pyaglia are connected by strands of pial cells across the subarachnoid space. There is no subpial space which intervenes between the pia mater and the underlying brain surface. In head injury, the subdural hemorrhage, so this is the subdural hemorrhage which is due to the slow collection of the venous blood caused by the tearing of the veins. Whereas the subarachnoid hemorrhage, so this is a subarachnoid hemorrhage, it is arterial due to the rupture of an aneurysm. This is the extradural hemorrhage. So this extradural hemorrhage results from the torn meningeal vessels associated with the fracture of the skull bones. As you know, the meningeal layer of the dura mater, it folds itself to form the partition which divides the cranial cavity into compartments which lodges different part of the brain. The folds are fox cerebri, tentorium cerebelli, fox cerebelli, then you have diaphragma cella. Now we'll study about the fox cerebri. So this is the fox cerebri. The fox cerebri is a large sickle-shaped fold of dura mater occupying the median longitudinal fissure between the two cerebellar hemispheres. It has an anterior end, so this is the anterior end and this is the posterior end. The anterior end is narrow and it is attached to the crista galli. So this is the crista galli. So anterior end is attached to the crista galli. The posterior end is broad and it is attached along the median plane to the upper surface of the tentorium cerebelli. So this is the tentorium cerebelli. So the posterior end of the fox cerebri is attached to the upper surface of the tentorium cerebelli. The fox cerebri has two margins. So this is the upper margin and the lower margin. The upper margin is convex and it is attached to the lips of the sagittal sulcus. And the lower margin is concave and free. So this is the lips of the sagittal sulcus. So where the upper margin of the fox cerebri is attached. Then you have the right and the left lateral surface. So this is the lateral surface which is related to the medial surface of the corresponding cerebral hemisphere. So this is the cerebral hemisphere. So this is the medial surface. The lateral surface of the fox cerebri is related to the medial surface of the corresponding cerebral hemisphere. Three important dural venous sinuses are related to the fox cerebri. Along the upper margin, you have the superior sagittal sinus. Along the lower margin, you have the inferior sagittal sinus. And along the attachment to the tentorium cerebelli, you have the straight sinus. Next, we'll study about the tentorium cerebelli. The tentorium cerebelli is the tent-shaped fold of dura mater forming the roof of the posterior cranial fossa. It separates the cerebellum, so here you have the cerebellum, from the occipital lobe of the cerebrum. And this tentorium cerebelli divides the cranial cavity into supratentorial and the infratentorial compartment. The infratentorial compartment is the posterior cranial fossa containing the hindbrain and the lower part of the midbrain. Next, we'll see about the attachment. So, the tentorium cerebelli has a free margin. So, this is the free margin and an attached margin. The free margin is anterior and it is U-shaped. So this is U-shaped. The anterior ends of the U are attached to the anterior clinoid process. The anterior free margin forms the tentorial notch. So this is the tentorial notch, which is occupied by the midbrain and the anterior part of the vermis. Next we'll see about the outer margin or the attached margin. The attached margin is attached to the lips of the transverse sulcus, which is present in the occipital bone, and to the posteroinferior angle of the parietal bone, then to the superior border of the petrous bone up to the posterior clinoid process. Next, we'll see about the trigeminal cave or Meckel's cave. So, this is a recess of the dura mater present in relation to the attached margin of the tentorium. It is formed by the evagination of the inferior layer of the tentorium over the trigeminal impression on the petrous part of the temporal bone. It contains the trigeminal ganglion. The free and the attached margin of the tentorium cerebelli cross each other near the apex of the petrous part of the temporal bone, and anterior to the point of crossing, there is a triangular area forms the posterior part of the roof of the cavernous sinus, and it is pierced by the third and the fourth cranial nerve. The tentorium cerebelli has two surfaces. So this is the superior surface, and this is convex and slopes to either side from the median plane. The fox cerebri, so this is the fox cerebri, which is attached to the superior surface in the median plane. Along the attachment, you have the straight sinus. The superior surface of the tentorium cerebelli is related to the occipital lobe of the cerebrum. Next, we'll see about the inferior surface of the tentorium cerebelli. The inferior surface is concave and fits the convex superior surface of the cerebellum. So, this is the cerebellum. The fox cerebelli is attached to the posterior part of the inferior surface of the tentorium cerebelli in the median plane. Now, we'll study about the fox cerebelli. It is a small sickle-shaped fold of dura mater projecting forwards into the posterior cerebellar notch. The base is attached to the posterior part of the inferior surface of the tentorium cerebelli in a median plane, and this is the apex, which usually divides into two parts, and it is attached to the margins of the foramen magnum. This is the posterior margin, which is attached to the internal occipital crest. This encloses the occipital sinus, and this is the anterior margin, which is free. Next, we'll study about the diaphragma cella. It is a small circular horizontal fold of dura mater forms the roof of the hypophyseal fossa. So, this is anteriorly attached to the tuberculum cellae, and posteriorly it is attached to the dorsum cella. On each side, it is continuous with the dura mater of the middle cranial fossa. The diaphragma cella has a center opening for the stalk of the pituitary gland. When you see the blood supply of the dura mater, the outer layer is richly vascular and the inner meningeal layer is more fibrous and requires a little blood supply. The vault or the supratentorial space is supplied by the middle meningeal artery. The anterior cranial fossa and the dural lining is supplied by the meningeal branch of the anterior ethmoidal, posterior ethmoidal and the ophthalmic arteries. And the middle cranial fossa is supplied by the middle meningeal, accessory meningeal and the internal carotid artery, and also by the meningeal branch of the ascending pharyngeal artery. The posterior cranial fossa is supplied by the meningeal branches of the vertebral, occipital and the ascending pharyngeal arteries. Next, the nerve supply. The dura mater of the vault has only a few sensory nerves, which are derived mostly from the ophthalmic division of the trigeminal nerve. The dura of the floor has a rich nerve supply and it is quite sensitive to pain. The anterior cranial fossa is mostly supplied by the anterior ethmoidal nerve and partly by the maxillary nerve. The middle cranial fossa is supplied by the maxillary nerve in its anterior half and by the branches of the mandibular nerve and from the trigeminal ganglion in its posterior half. The posterior cranial fossa is supplied chiefly by the recurrent branches from the first, second, third cervical spinal nerves and partly by the meningeal branches of the 9th and the 10th cranial nerves.